My relationship with John 3:17 started when my sister, Erin, said that she was coming here. I'd never heard of John 3:17, but throughout the entire process, my heart stayed tied to the availability of recovery to my sister because she had been in addiction for a couple of decades at that point. And so quickly after her graduation, which I began to see that Erin also had a capacity for ministry and that we were going to be in ministry together. And so I was very intentional about following up and trying to honor what John 3:17 had done for our family. And so I believe that God linked us together. I also believe that because of perseverance and faithfulness, Erin saw the recovery road through to fruition in her life, and that John 3:17 was the vehicle in which that happened. And so for us as a family, what we were really committed to was just honoring what that investment into Erin was. And so any way that the Lord has allowed us to do that, we've just been trying to do that. And it's been now close to 3 years that we've been just kind of partnering together here and there. But that's how it started, is just I never heard of it. And then the rescue of my sister, and then this intentional follow-up that said, I always want to honor John 3:17 because of what they've done for our family.
My now husband went to jail, and before that, really, I mean, I remember just being at rock bottom, not even wanting to get high anymore. But I didn't have a vehicle, you know, I barely had a phone. The judge told him, you're gonna get help or you're gonna be in jail. He came through the door. We lived in a mechanic shop, and we had built a loft, and I was just laying in there, and he goes, we're going to rehab. I had honestly, even though I had been in addiction for so long, I had never even considered going to rehab because I couldn't get out of my mess that I was in without Jesus, number one, but without some real intervention help. We just got what we could and moved to his parents' house. All the while, you know, I just barely had contact with my mom and my sister, letting them know what, you know, my next steps were. I just remember. She made no bones. She was like, look, how do we know that you're ready? You know? And I said, well, I said, I'll sleep on the floor, whatever I gotta do. And I didn't have to sleep on the floor, but I did sleep on a cot for a little while, and it was just as many, I'd say most of us are when we get here. There's just broken relationships. Your identity is all messed up because it's either been in on a man or just a lot of times your identity is found in your failures because you just feel like you're never gonna be amount to anything. But that's what you learn here is through God's word that He has created you and He doesn't make mistakes. And they just disciple you, give you every kind of opportunity, whether it be get your license back, go to get your GED or anything like that. So I really appreciate that. And there's just an endless opportunity here. After at least the first couple of months, I knew that I was going to stay. Accepting Jesus into my heart and making him Lord of my life was the best decision I ever made. The second best decision I ever made was coming to John 3:17. So it's helped me restore my relationship with my sister, my mom, my kids, has equipped me to, you know, stand firm on God's promises. So I've always been a hard worker, but it helped me, you know, realizing that it's not just work, but it's actually service to God in everything that you do. And no matter if it's cleaning toilets or if it's, you know, helping someone cross the street, just whatever it is, you want to give honor to God. And I've definitely learned that here. Am I perfect at it? Absolutely not. But just knowing that even if you say please, thank you, yes ma'am, no ma'am, giving honor, it's a fruit of the spirit, kindness. And so, yes, I definitely learned about the fruits of the spirit here. And if you're in a place where you have this many women, broken women, women that are just coming out of their fog of addiction, women that are dealing with hard things, a little kindness goes a long way.
I would say that if you have a family member that's in addiction, one of the things that I would first say is that I'm sorry. And that God has not forgotten the people who are suffering from their own consequences. Addiction is illness, right? So a lot of times we think of an addict as somebody who can fix themselves and they deserve to have a hard life because they've chosen addiction. But God doesn't forsake the people who are going through consequences of their own actions, and we can't either. And so I would encourage you, if you have a family member that is in addiction, to number one, surrender them to the Lord. Because I know you've been hurt by them, and I know that you've suffered, and probably at the hand of their addiction, the deception or the rejection or the hiding or the stealing or whatever the other symptoms or side effects of addiction is or are, you've probably suffered because of having a family member in addiction. But I would encourage you to surrender the pain and the fighting and the strife and the control to the Lord. And I don't say that lightly. I say that through experience and through the conviction of the Holy Spirit in my own life, trying to help my family member in addiction and my own strength failed. For years, honestly, it failed. But 5 years before Aaron came into recovery, I had to surrender fully the fight to rescue her to the Lord. And the only way I knew how to do that was to forgive her prematurely, because she hadn't asked for forgiveness. She had to forgive her for the things she wasn't sorry for. And the reason that I say it that way is because I was in pain because of her addiction. I was hurting. Because I was so desperate to see her healed, and I just knew how to not live in addiction. And so I just tried to tell her all the time and to try to take control of some things and lead her and offer her all kinds of rescue things, from money to jobs to safety to security to advice. I had offered her those things in my own strength for decades, and they had failed her. But the Lord told me to surrender. And to surrender, I had to forgive first, and I had to overcome my own pain. And I had to understand that my desperation was nothing compared to Jesus' desperation to see his people free, so much so that he gave his life. And so, when you surrender your family members, you do it by forgiving, by walking through healing of your own pain, and through standing in prayer with a pure heart and all faith in God that he is able. And I encourage you that he is able. And the way that I did that in my own life is that I prayed for Aaron at the same time every day for 5 years. And I can tell you that when I started praying that prayer, things got worse. They got worse. Before they got better, they got a lot worse. So for 5 years, I had to walk through the process of surrender. And that's my encouragement to you, whatever that means to you as a family member with somebody in addiction. Surrender. Have faith that God is able. Believe that his word is true. And see that when you look in a mirror, you're also a miracle. If you are a child of God, you're a miracle. And you know what he's done for you. And don't forsake having that faith for somebody else, even if you don't see that they want it for themselves yet. God loved you before you loved him. He loved you before you loved him. And he loves your loved one before they love him too. But you have to believe and show that you believe. Through standing firm in faith and praying, and do not give up or forsake your loved one in prayer, no matter how many times they reject you. And know that you can surrender the tasks to. Enabling them can be surrendered. Being angry with them can be surrendered. Being hurt by them, it can be surrendered. Trying to rescue them and save them, all of those things can be surrendered. So my encouragement to you is don't quit. And know that God is able.
Not to give up. And to the one who is seeking help. It's going to be hard. It's going to be just, sometimes you're not going to see or feel like you're doing it right or fast enough or, you know, but it's important not to compare yourself to anybody. Anybody else's story is not yours. And God created us that way. That's the way it's supposed to be. So just keep going. Stay here at John 3:17. Stay at the faith filled ministry that you're in. Don't let anything keep you from staying and seeking God in every situation. Sometimes, I know what helped me so much is writing, because, you know, you have to be, I mean, I wasn't the most disciplined person, obviously, so you learn self-discipline, which is a fruit of the Spirit, and writing down your prayers, writing down what you're feeling, writing those Bible verses. So journaling is a big thing that I totally recommend. But just stay. Keep going. Don't give up. God will never give up on you. I'll never give up on you.
I joined up with International Women's Ministry, and the vision there is actually so profound, but I think unique as well. Really what it's all about is going into places where women are seeking to advance the kingdom, their women ministries, and wiping the tears. That's the mission statement of International Women's Ministry, because what we realize is that women throughout the world trying to advance the kingdom, a lot of times are standing alone, and they feel unseen, they feel unheard, they feel uncelebrated. And so International Women's Ministry has the mission and the vision to come into spaces and host encouraging conferences, equipping, training, prayer retreats, discipleship resources, and just really lift up women in the kingdom. And so our founder and leader, Autumn Nims, has said that in the phrase of wiping tears. And many times I've been sent by International Women's Ministries into places where women do feel that very alone, and stood before them and said hard things, but also watched them flood the altar and God wiped those tears. And the Bible says that the Lord will bottle up those tears as a fragrance of worship unto him. And he does that because he is the one that lifts our head. And so as vessels for the kingdom, to be sent as women leaders or to be sent as encouragement to other women, it's an honor. And that's one of the ways that we connected through John 3:17, because it was already endeared to my heart and my family because of Aaron's testimony, but also just knowing that this is a layered opportunity to pour into women, because you do have founders and a board and mission and vision and hard fallow ground sometimes to contend for the kingdom. But you also have this team of rescued and restored leaders that are trying to then reproduce that same testimony in just a rolling roster of people coming here to find hope. And so many tears to wipe here, but also very fertile ground when it comes to what the work is. And so we have come here now 3 years in a row to do conferences through International Women's Ministries. And then, of course, Aaron is not on the board at International Women's Ministry, but she accompanies us as a support because of her connection here, just to give her time and to volunteer. And we always love to give her the opportunity to share and to bless and to pray. An exhorter. Erin is an exhorter, an encourager. And so it's such a blessing to have that open door here. And a lot of that is due to her faithfulness. And because of the reputation that's already been set here is that she's kind and she works hard. And so that's afforded us a connection. And then, of course, our other ministry is Mentoring Movement. Erin and I serve there together. And Mentoring Movement has the mission to intentionally disciple. And so that's where we serve together on the lead team. And so I always feel like, and she also leads prayer on our prayer team at Mentoring Movement. And so it has become, John 3:17 has become a training ground to train and equip women for ministry in the kingdom, not just to rescue them, as the mission says, which is let's give them hope, let's give them safety, let's restore them. But it's also a sending vessel that says also those who will stay and want to serve here on lead team, there are discovering what their gifts and their graces are for the kingdom and then being sent. And that's what Erin has found that Mentoring Movement is a place to be further those things that she's discovered that she's graced in here to further develop those, and now she serves the kingdom with those, which is something that endears me to John 3:17 in itself, is that there is a way for people to then recover, but also then been trained as what we know are workers, laborers in the kingdom. And so I love it. We love coming with International Women's Ministries. I love representing them as this is a mission field for us. And then also with Mentoring Movement, which is something that we do more so together, Erin and I. And so it's just a blessing. It's just a blessing to serve the kingdom and not to compete or not to have to come under a banner, but to know that the mission is just to love one another. And we all just, like the Bible says, we just take those gifts and we serve one another with them. So it's been a mutual exchange here. This ministry has served my family, has rescued us and restored us. And then we know because of these opportunities that we have, we can come back and serve